program. So we already have four webinars. This is the fifth one. We're looking at chapter 2, 3, and 4 today. And we will organize a webinar 6. We can have chapters 6 and 7 later on, probably something toward the end of September, early October. And we will have then cover all the chapters of the plan. But as well as the webinars, we've got one-to-one support available. And to date, we had 39 stations, and I would encourage you to use those stations. They are more specific to your own business, and that's where we can support you more directly, less generic like the webinars are. And they can be on Teams, or we could, I think, consider having them in-house. I think now we are past level zero. So we could consider having those sessions in there. So have a look into that, and please come in to Scottish Engineering and ask if you think it would be beneficial. Another thing I wanted to highlight is the slides are available on the website if you go to the net zero. Now, what you need to do is click on the video, and the video will take you to a page where you'll see there is a link for the slides. So you don't need to go through the whole video, the whole 90 minutes presentation. You can go directly to the slides and pick and choose what is most relevant for yourself. So if you look at innovation, if you remember, we started with stakeholders, and we were trying to figure out what we need to get innovations, and we obviously need to start with a vision. And that was part one, where we looked at the why. Why do we want to do that? What's the vision? And then you need a market, and the market drives the motivations, and usually that comes from your customer. And that was the what we talked about in webinar one, was the why and the what. And then if you add to that the capabilities, and you get capabilities thanks to the technology, and that could be the skills, or the will be skills, but it can be related to equipment, it can be soft skill, hard skill, then we will come in more details to that. But you need a capability, and then you need a roadmap, which is looking at the business and the business strategy. And we looked at policy, and that was part 3 and 4, which we covered in webinar 2. And if you've got all 4, you've got innovations. And the takeaway from this side is that if you're missing one of them, then you are likely not to deliver what you're aiming at delivering. So for example, if you don't have a vision, you're just going to create confusion. If you don't have motivations, then you're going to create resistance. And if you don't have the capability to do what you want to do, then you're going to generate frustration. And finally, for the whole thing to stick together, you need a roadmap, otherwise all that work will be wasted. So that's what we did and what we looked at, and that's how we ended up innovations out of webinar 1 and 2, and the skills that will be required to deliver those innovations and the opportunities. So we then developed a framework which we use for webinars 3 and 4 that cover chapter 1, 5, and 8. And in terms of vision, we looked at innovations, which a lot of it was coming by the feedback we got out of webinar 2 from the attendee at the time. And we looked at innovation in Scotland, innovation in the UK, and innovation further afield. And the idea here was to find out how those companies out there leverage those opportunities. And the opportunities defined the motivations. And for that, we looked at the climate change plan from the Scottish Government, which are clearly defined outcomes, actions, and then we looked at project that people can get involved in the specific chapters. Develop is developing the capability, and in terms of capability, we focused on skills. And for that, we focused on CSAP, that was developed by LTS, Skills Development Scotland. And we looked at what are the needs, how do you access those, and how can you fund them? So that's developing the capability. And finally, we looked at the roadmap. And the roadmap is pathways. We looked at tools available to get there, process and funding. So that's the methodology we've used for those 3 chapters. And that's the methodology we're anticipating to use today for those three chapters, which is building, transport and industry. And we'll start with discover, which is the innovation piece. So if we looked at the action, I've created or used, not only created, used icons to highlight the area where the innovation is tapping into the opportunities. So in terms of standards and regulation, that's mainly about efficiency. In terms of supply chain growth, it's mainly about heat and heat creation, heat distribution, heat conservation. It's about innovation, and we know about that. And there is a strong focus on heat pump. Heat pump is a key deliverable for the building industry. If I look at transport, then you really need to think at all forms of travels or all forms of logistics. So being active travel, being cars, being public transport, being buses, plane, train, and freight. It could be HEV or lorries, road freight, sea freight, air freight. So transport is about all the mobility versions. If you look at industry, where are the actions? The actions are in ETS, which is the emission trading scheme, which is carbon capture. The next one, the big one, is on carbon capture utilization and storage, CCUS. And you've got also hydrogen. And here again, you've got efficiency and innovations, as you would expect. So that's the plan for the industry. If I look at the innovation, I'm going to present them to you. So we need, as I said, the four pillars above to deliver innovations. And I'll let you know for each innovation, if it's Scotland, the UK, further afield, and where relevant, the academia that was involved in supporting that. And then we'll look at or opportunities leveraging through those icons for building, transport, and industry. So this is how the page of innovations or the slides of innovation are going to be made of. So if I start with building, and in the building, you can see that there is a four icon, which is efficiency, heat, innovation, and heat pump. So if I look at the first one, is Kenotech. Kenotech is a company I mentioned before, but the takeaway, I mentioned it before because they were as part of the circularity, because they were using demolition waste. But what is interesting here is they are doing that by what I would call remanufacturing, because they're using that demolition waste to create bricks for building again. So it's a circularity. But it's a waste which is recycled where it comes from, is to make buildings. So that's an interesting one that was done in Scotland with a university as a support. So this is an innovation in the building sector. Another innovation, but in the UK, is about a platform created by architect. And it's about gauging before building the building, what its footprint is going to be, what its carbon footprint, how net zero is it going to be. And the takeaway here is about planning, but also it's about not everything needs to be big hardware. It could be software, innovations, and net zero are quite wide. So here you're looking at efficiency, again, innovations, and you're looking at heat controls. So that's another one. In another innovation, which is in here, in this case, football in the building industry, and that's a football club which is looking at becoming carbon neutral. And they are trying to do that by building a stand based on wood. It's a whole wood stadium. And the concept here is for the building industry to become, I would say, more renewable, more net zero, then we are looking at bringing in, you know, using wood more than concrete. Concrete is a high emitter. So how do we manage to minimize the use of concrete? And one of the options is to look at wood. So that's the innovation here, is a whole wood stadium. But in terms of building, you also can look at generating your own energy. And that is why it's been working in the UK, in buildings, and with the support of Welsh University, and it's about generating energy to A, feed the building or address the user needs of the building, and what they've been, the model here is a classroom and offices. But what they develop is a system that can deliver one lifetime the energy needed by the building. So that means they can use the extra energy to charge their cars or anything like that. So that's another way for a building to become net zero. So when you're starting to come through here, it's really for the engineering and manufacturing sector, is how do you service, how do you help those buildings, say the building sector, to become net zero, rather than actually building net zero, but how do you bring it on table, the technology? Another one in the building sector in the UK is about carbon capture. And here the idea is when you create, you know, building material like tiles, then capture the carbon and reuse what you've captured to make the next set of tiles. So capturing carbon is quite a big one. And again, it's how to create a building which are net zero. And again, it's about servicing that industry. We'll come to that. The building industry, we can't do without. We're going to need to build things to become net zero. But how do you support them? How do you help them becoming net zero? That's what you're really trying to look at. What in your technology, and it could be hardware or software, can be apps, what can you use to help them becoming net zero? Another one here in the building and further afield is MCrete, for example. And that's the development of a material, because materials has a big impact on the building industry, and developing a material which is based on hemp, and hemp because it locks a lot of the carbon, and by mixing hemp in concrete, then you end up locking away all that carbon, and then so the outcome of it is that you lock away enough carbon that is more than what the construction is going to emit. So you end up with a carbon negative, I would say carbon negative situation, because you're locking away. So in here, you're using carbon capture, which is hemp, utilization, which is building, and storage, which you store that hemp away for the life of the building. The other area that we say is manufacturing, the other area is 3D printing. And you can think about 3D printing, other small parts that people tend to do, but more and more people are looking at 3D printing houses, because the good advantage of 3D printing is it's minimum waste creation. So that's what people are looking at. And here what you've got is a 3D printing building, but it's based on concrete. So what they are 3D printing is concrete. The advantage of it is how quickly you can build it, and you can go anywhere almost to build it, which is especially in area difficult of access. But that is still concrete, and that is for emergency building. But it doesn't all have to be concrete, and it doesn't all have to be for emergency. And what you have here is 3D printed building, which is basically prefabricated building, which are very nice with all mod cons. But what you see in the building industry more and more, and again, that's where there is an opportunity, is prefabricated building where people are buying buildings that are being made off-site. So they are really being brought in and assembled a bit like, if you want, not Flatpak, but a bit like IKEA, on site, and that industry is growing, and that's a trend, and that's an industry that could be helped with. There is an interesting video where you can go online with a 10-story building that was built in a day, and that was thanks to the fact that all parts were made on site, and they were just delivered on site and assembled. So that's an idea, and that's 3D printing. Another area of innovation, and that's less more on the world of app and IoT and that sort of thing, is in this case, for example, is energy from the solar energy, which is being used to feed Wi-Fi. And the idea here is to narrow what they call the digital divide. And there is a big trend or a big request in that green recovery as no one left behind. And that's what this is addressing, really, is making sure that people on low income, in this case, have access, free access to Wi-Fi through feeding the system via a solar panel on the building. So again, you can see here how it is supporting the building becoming net zero. And that's where the opportunity is. So where are opportunities in general in the building industry? Well, you've got construction, we talked about it, especially in terms of materials, automation and 3D, looking at, you know, equipment and difficult to access state and method, which is like prefabrication. And there's a big aim on marine, and that is like the offshore tree, especially in Scotland, but also subsea installations and harbour, geotechnical, and about, you know, the difficult site access. So that's what we're talking about when we talked about 3D printing, land reclamation, and infrastructure. So infrastructure is a big one, which is transportation, storage of water. You've got earthworks, you've got all the drainage that comes with it, and a pipe infrastructure. So how do you use pipe and recycle pipes and reuse? Think about, you know, reuse, remanufacturing, repair, all that sort of things. And then waste, so we talked about that, but it's about what do you do with the rubble, what do you do with the demolition process itself, and then the equipment you use to demolish things, and have you got the infrastructure to manage that waste? And that's the idea about recycling, that's the idea of reusing and remanufacturing. And finally, you've got utilities, and utilities is about, you know, fuel handling, is about building for water treatment, building harbors, you know, for power distribution, or even like we're talking about hydrogen or carbon capture. So all those are part of the utility management. So you can see there is a lot of opportunity, but for the engineering and manufacturing industry, the opportunity is really into serving that sector, the building sector. If we look at the next chapter, chapter 3, which is on transport, and they've got all the icons there that I mentioned earlier on. And really the greenest way is walking, as we all know. And the most CO2 emitting is plane air travel. And that's based, all the work on transport is based on those, and it's looking at each one of those and then how you go from air to walking, basically, and kill or stop as much as air travel as you can and maximize your walking or your active traveling. So the first example would be in Scotland, would be Swift H2. And the concept here was about really marine, but it's about how to use wind farm, so green electricity, to create hydrogen, which is then a clean fuel, and use that hydrogen to power a ferry to go to the isle. So that's where you can see the whole supply chain involved in there. But the starting point is really about shipping. How do you get green shipping and green ferrying, in this case, the ferries? And the idea here is how you create green hydrogen through wind farm and electrolyzer. So that's the first one about transport. Another one in Scotland is an app for disabled passengers. It's to make sure that they receive personalized support. So what you have here, again, is an innovation which isn't a big wind farm and hydrogen and electrolyzer and ship. It's an app, but it's still an innovation, and where no one is left behind, and I include any people with disability or anything like that. So that's in this case for air travel. But again, when you think about innovation, think widely. Another one here is you're thinking about active travel and you're talking about walking, and that's UK with Imperial College London. And the concept here is how you protect the people that work, how you protect the active people. And here, so the innovation is about those deflectors to deflect to protect the pedestrians and deflect pollution from the pedestrian. So if you think about, again, innovation, you know, it's about protecting the active commuters. You know, it goes further than just the commuting itself. It's a protection part of it. Interestingly enough, again, is electrical vehicle go a lot further than the big one, like the cars and the buses and the trains. And in this case, is someone which is looking at, you know, all the scooters have been trending on the up. There's more and more interest. But people want it to be green. So how do you marry the two? And what that gentleman has been doing in London is developing an innovation which is about transforming old scooter into green scooters without losing the look and feel of the scooters. So you can see here, it doesn't have to be all big. And the whole idea about it is about getting green and moving things which aren't green, which aren't net zero, to the world of net zero. And here, again, in the UK, what you're looking at is the next bit, which is public transport. And in this case, it's autonomous public transport. And that's really the takeaway from that one. It's innovation. It's that it's autonomous. There is no driver anymore. You've been driven, picked up and driven around. The challenge in automation, and I'll come back to that, is trust. How do you trust that you're going to go safely where you want to go? So that's, again, you know, a concept that's been developed for automated, in the UK, automated public transport. And then you've got the big boys also looking into it. And in this case, it's EasyJet looking at electrical plane. And they are planning to have electrical plane within 10 years. And further afield, when I come to that, I mention another area where there is progress, but there is big ambitions here for planes to become electric planes, as you've seen earlier on, is the biggest emitter of greenhouse gases. And more closer to home, I would say, well, it's a further afield, but it's closer to home in the sense that you can use cars and trains and ships and lorries. It's about collecting and capturing all that soot and then making ink out of it, which is what those guys have been doing. So you've got a full circularity. And basically, they capture the soot and make ink out of it. And you can imagine that they do that out of a compressor, which could be of interest to our membership again. But they may also do that out of cars and buses and lorries and ships and trains. So if can you capture that and make something out of it while releasing it in the atmosphere? And this innovation here is about transport, is about sharing, but more importantly, it's about in here is mobility as a service. In this case, it's micro mobility because it's a small e-scooter. But basically, what you do is you get one and move around the city, and the same way you've got bike in Glasgow and e-bikes. So they've been looking at micro mobility in two pilots, one in France and one in Germany, and that's why you get. So here you're thinking about mobility as a service, and I'll come back to that. But not all of it has to be. We understand a new service, innovation could be a new service. It doesn't have to be a product. Here, further afield, what's interesting is the pivot. So you've got a yacht manufacturer that's got a unique technology on solar panel. And they've been thinking about what can I do with that technology? And what they found is that if they put their technology, which is a solar panel from yachts, on the roof of a car, for an electric car, then they deliver what the electric car needs. So that's an interesting innovation in terms of pivoting. So how do you go from yachts to cars? And that's what I find interesting in that one, is a pivot, and that's what you're going to be looking at. And in terms of transport and care, another thing is about what else can you do with those cars? What else can you do with those batteries? And the concept here is charging the cars and using the cars as buffers if you need electricity. So they are power holder, if you want, on behalf of the city. And if they are not used, then they can get the power back. So now you've got two uses for the car. The one use is about using it as a car, but the other use is about using it as a I would say storage of energy, a storage of electricity. So that's an interesting concept. This is about how many use of the same thing can you get. Halo is the one which is trying to address that trust concern. And the reason for that, so in here, is almost autonomous in the sense that there is no driver in the car, but the car is driven remotely. So you still have a human involved, but that human is doing it remotely. So it's not quite 100% autonomous, because you've still got human intervention, but it is without a driver. So when you jump the car, there's nobody in it. So that's an interesting concept, is trying to go halfway and trying to build that trust. That's really what it's about. And that one is about, again, transportations and moving to the marine sector, maritime sector. And it's to really encourage active travel. And to encourage active travel, you need obviously net zero. That's why it's green, electric, and autonomous. But convenience is a big trend in the consumer. It's how do you make it convenient? And that's convenient by being on demand. So you've got a solution which is going to encourage active traveling, active commuting, thanks to the on-demand piece of it. So that's the one that's in the maritime sector. To carry on the maritime sector, what is recognized is there is a lot of emission by all those ships traveling around the world delivering our product globally. And the idea here is to use sail. So there's been a lot of development. And in this case, the sails, rotor sail, are already used to sail. Now used to create electricity, which is then used to propel the boat. So that. But more and more people are wondering how much power can I generate using sail power, regardless of the way to do it. So I can decrease the use of fuel, or I would say gas or diesel or whatever oil-based fuel you have. So that's another innovation. And there is a lot of work happening in that, and that's an area where, again, we as in Scotland could make a difference. Talking about EasyJet and the airplane. So here you've got, electrically powered, based on batteries technology that exists today. And that's short haul, you're looking at 250 miles. So short haul plane, but it's advanced and proved well enough that in this case, you need to carry United Airlines as made an order of 200 planes, so that's how serious this is. So that's another innovation in the world of transport. So if you look at the opportunity in the world of transport, it's really about battery and what you can do to lightweight, maximize the battery usage and delivery of power. It's about fuel cell and fuel cell manufacturing, but also about your fuel. So you're thinking about hybridization. So if you've got vehicles that leave the work, and it could be heavy duty vehicle, but they will have two systems, and one is probably likely to be a combustion engine, and the other one is likely to be electric or hydrogen. So dual fuel vehicles. And then when you've got a combustion engine, you know, what do you do with the exhaust gas? So I've talked about, for example, the ink, or can you capture that? Can you do something with it? And then in terms of connected and autonomous vehicles, the concern here is safety, is trust. So that's going to be the first hurdle to address. And that's what we talked about, because that's what, you know, you've got a company looking at the in-between, which is still with a human intervention, but it's remote. So those are the opportunities in more generic terms for transport. The industry, the chapter four. So again, the icons about hydrogen and carbon capture and ETS and innovation and efficiencies. So an example here in Scotland is in Innovatus Tech Technology. And they are looking at leveraging the hydrogen opportunities and developing basically carbon fiber containers specifically for the hydrogen technology. So that's an innovation which is in Scotland and tapping into, if you want, into the opportunity action the government is taking care of. Another one interesting industry is it's light as a service, which is Juiced, which used to be called Market LED. And what they provide is what the customer buys is light. What they provide is the fittings, the equipment, the maintenance, etc. But what the customer buys light. So it's light as a service, it's a leasing model. So here the innovation is in the service, it's not really in the technology. It's not really in a hardware, it's in a service. So that's another way to look at innovation in the industry. What can you do as a service? You know, it would be like LaaS, they would say light as a service. And here, and there is an area which is the drink industry, an industry which is keen on looking at becoming net zero, especially for direct conversation with the customers and the consumers, or I would say marketing reason. And what that shows is for an industry which is really high energy consuming, and that's probably why they have a strong interest in hydrogen, then it's possible, it's achievable to become net zero. And in this case, you've got a whiskey distillery which has become net zero. So they do use a bit of ETS to get there, but that just shows how it is achievable. It's not out of reach. And if you go further afield, it's not just like the UK, it's not just whiskey, but in this case it's gin and vodka. So again, another company that's managed to become net zero and using still the level of ETS, but it is feasible. In this case, from an industry which is quite interesting, it's minimizing, you can think about it as minimizing the commuting. It's bringing the line to the people rather than bringing the people to the line. And the idea here is you've got a line, pre-made line from a nano factory, they call it, which you can take to wherever it's needed. So the concept here is how you develop lines and systems and processes that can be brought where the people live, rather than the other way around, is moving the people around and cutting the commuting in the process. That's about, and again, an innovation which is about carbon offsetting. And what is of interest here, and what's going to be challenging, is when you go and look at offsetting, you know, how do you offset? Who do you pay? What do you do? How do you get certification? It's all those ETS, so that's why it's about carbon capture. And that's an innovation trying to address that by trying to, if you want, address what a lot of what you've heard about, which is greenwashing, with everybody claiming to get zero claiming to be green, everybody making some claims. And then what they are looking at is an app here. So again, think about innovation in the software point of view rather than the hardware point of view. So it's an app that allows you to gauge what ATS you want to use and which ones are making a difference. Talking about ATS, that's another interesting idea, which is create your own ATS. So what those guys have done, they develop a device that do carbon capture, which can be put in people's houses or plants or buildings and factories. But more interestingly, I think what they are looking at is using their own technology to become an ETS. So can they develop something, use their technology and develop something so they get accreditation to become an ETS and therefore being paid to capture all that carbon. So that's another area of innovation, is how can you use your own technology to become an ETS yourself. Along the same line, but using something different, there is a recognition that probably the chemicals we're using today are the chemicals we're going to use tomorrow. And the question is, how do I change the source for those chemicals from oil and gas to CO2 emissions? And that's what those guys are trying to do it by the same way that the plant does, which is photosynthesis, and recycle those CO2 emissions into those key chemicals we're going to need to make products and materials. So again, here you can see the concept of CO2 emission being recycled. So in chapter 4, what are the options? So you're looking at efficiency improvements. So anything that tap into that, and a lot of it is about digitization and Industry 4.0. It's about efficiency in equipment. Is a bit efficiency in the material use for within the industry. And then you've got the alternative process technology. So it's how you develop a new processes, especially in the world of, for example, cement production. You've got here as an example, or ceramics, but how you develop technology that use less energy. Or different energy in here. You think about the distilleries. And then you've got the low carbon substitutes, which is another opportunities. And here, things about, you've got the fuel switching. So how you move to electricity, how you move to hydrogen, how you move away from all the fossil fuels. And then the raw materials. So the example here would have been how do you make chemicals out of captured carbon? So CCUS, again, carbon capture, and then utilization to make materials, and storage is stored in the materials. But other areas for innovations would be the recovery and recycling. So it's reuse, so what can you do? And heat recovery, energy system. So again, it's all about storage creation, generation, and conservation of energy. And the last one is about clustering. And what that is about is how you share. So maybe how you share heat, how you share maybe electricity if you're doing your own. Think about the ETS, how do you also become an ETS yourself? And help basically your neighbors becoming net zero. That's the concept behind it, because people tend to buy ETS which are nearby rather by ETS around the world. So those are opportunities again for innovations in the circular industry. So what's the takeaway from all those innovation? Well, in terms of building, then we will not be able to do there without the construction industry. We'll need the construction to get net zero. But the construction industry is also one of the biggest emitters. So the challenge is that how do you help that industry becoming net zero? And as you've seen here, there's a massive range of opportunities of how to help them. In terms of transport, think about everything that moves, basically. And that goes from e-scooters to airplanes, from public transport to micro-mobilities, from no one left behind to the 20-minute neighborhoods. We've been talking about the discussion we've been talking about. So that's transport. In industry, you need to think about achieving net zero as possible. And that's what we're showing, for example, through the various distilleries, but also look at industry as a service. As I mentioned earlier on, guys, think about LED system. You provide a service, you don't provide a product. And that's my last point on the takeaway, which is innovations are not just product innovation now also process innovation, and think about innovation as a service. So that's the takeaway I think I would take from those chapters. So I think that's sort of setting a ratio midway point. So I suggest we take a break, 5 minute break, and then we'll reconvene in 5 minutes. Okay, thanks everybody. Thanks for staying with us. I think we're going to now go on to the next part, which is looking at define, which is the opportunities and the motivations behind those chapters 2, 3, and 4. So if I start with the building, and it's true for all three chapters, is the Scottish Government is looking for outcomes, which are described here. And those outcomes are going to drive policies, and those policies will be linked to funding when it's relevant. But more importantly, those policies are going to create opportunities. So that's why you want to look at what they are looking at as an outcomes, because that's going to drive opportunities. And one in the building chapter, the first outcome is about heat. And it's about heat, its supply, it's about heat, its generation, it's about heat, its conservation, and how you can help. So that's where you've got renewable and zero emission heating. That's what you've got the outcome two is about efficiency, and it's a fabric efficiency. So we talked about M-Crete, for example, we talked about 3D printing. And the next outcome number three, is about green gas. And that's what we've talked about, hydrogen, but also biogas, like biomedicine. And it's about decarbonizing the gas supply and decarbonize that gas supply for household principally, but also for companies. And we talked about distilleries and hydrogen and that sort of things. And the outcome number four, the big one for them, is no one left behind. And especially in that heat transition, is that it can't be said so the heat become the heat costs become prohibitive, and then we have got people left behind. And how can you stimulate employment? And that's why it's about employment. We talked about it before in webinar 1 and 2, it's about employment, no one left behind, and the willingness that employees have in learning new skills. And that's all about skill. That's all about, again, Skill Development Scotland has got a big impact on that. And that's where CSAP came out of. So if I look at more general, more information on the actions, what you'll find out is a lot about heat. It's generation, it's conservation, it's about heat pump, it's about heat network. So in terms of building, the first thing is about heat. The second one is about innovations and how you innovate, how you demonstrate, how you do new technologies. So the second one is about innovations. And the third one is about skills and skills, how you get them in colleges, how you get them in-house, how you get them on, you know, the OSF, on the job, or social or formal. And again, that's where you get SDS that came up with the CSAP plan. But, and it's always about, if those outcomes don't come through, then their actions will be on developing regulation, legislation, standardizations, what people usually see as red tape. And if it still doesn't happen, they look at us and how do they set up a tank system that makes sure the outcomes are being delivered. Being net zero by 2045 is a legal requirement that the Scottish Government put upon themselves. So whereas today they are using the carrot of investment and funding, if it doesn't deliver those outcomes I've just talked about, it's likely that they'll be starting to use the stick of taxation and taxonomy and regulation and legislation. And that's what you are looking at here, is they give themselves that options to get there. So what is in the building industry, what's the opportunity? What are the big projects? So that's what I was talking about earlier on. You can see that being short, medium or long term, you know, being hydrogen or carbon capture and oil and gas, there is a need for the construction industry to be involved and support all those ambitions, you know, being even direct air capture, carbon capture, you know. So in the longer term. So the message here is that you can't do without the construction industry. And the key recommendations is then to identify the gaps, the skill gaps to deliver on those specific topic. It could be even nuclear, it could be hydrogen, it could be ammonia, it could be carbon capture. And then minimize the skills shortage and leverage the policy and innovation that present. So an example of such a big project is you've got here, is the largest net zero housing development in Scotland, which is going to be at Embrawley. And they are looking at, again, technology and building fabric. So you're looking again at materials, you're looking again at technology. And that's a project that can be saved, you know, to deliver that information. It's not about building it, in our case, as the years of Scottish Engineering for that matter, but it's about how do you support that building industry. Another one along the same line is about the infrastructure. And here you've got, you know, Scottish Power building an infrastructure, because in building a big deal is about heat pumps and cars, and basically what people see is an increase in demand of electricity, electrification, and therefore how do you build the infrastructure that's going to support that. So again, it's about building it, but it's also about serving the people that builds it. While the outcomes in transport, and again, it's all about, you're looking at outcomes because outcomes will ultimately drive opportunities. And then what you can see here, it's about tapping into all modes of transport. So you're looking at cars, you're looking at vans, you could have people, but you're also looking at goods with freights, and you're looking at all sectors on the road, on the sea, on the rail, in the air. So that they want to have an impact on all modes of transport, all modes of mobility. And that's where the e-scooters concept is coming from. So that's what they are looking at, taking the car off the road, minimizing the use of freight, minimizing the use of land, maximizing the use of public transport, and doing the same thing for air, sea, and rail. So if I look at the actions, then you've got basically the active travel. So the 20 minutes neighborhood, I've mentioned, and walking and cycling. And if you remember in the structure, in the ranking, those are probably the most net zero. But in terms of innovation, then you need to think about, you know, bringing the line to the people, right? Bringing the people to the line. The other area is all modes of transport. I've just mentioned that I've been from bus to cars to plane to ferries, name it, it's all being considered. But again, here, like we saw in the previous chapter, they are looking at the possibility of a workplace parking levy. So another way to tax businesses if the outcomes are not coming through. So by putting a parking levy on your parking at work, so to force active travel, to force public transport, that sort of thing. So what have you got big project-wise where we can get involved in? One of them is Scottish Power again, looking at COP26, looking at that increase in the demand and preparing the grid. And what they're looking at here is police cars, interestingly enough, and buses. So the public services, like the police, or the part of the commuting public transport, like the buses. So but they recognize that everything we want to do in terms of electrification will require a better grid. And that's really what they are looking at. So that's one of the big projects. Another big project is Alexander Dennis, which is looking at, you know, hydrogen bus. So that's again, and you can see the wind turbine in the background here. So green hydrogen, as well as probably blue hydrogen to start with, and carbon capture. But that's another big project you can be looking at. And another one is the Transport Scotland, which is looking at developing that zero emission mobility innovation and relocate facility, which is looking at the heavy side of things, which is like powertrain, which is heavy duty vehicles. But you can see how there is a big investment. Think about the car that I mentioned earlier on. Big investment in terms of how you develop an innovation centers, and you've got something like that already similar to that innovation park. So that's one. Another one of them in the rail industry for the passenger train. So we looked at heavy goods earlier on the previous slide. In this slide, it's more about looking at train, and again, it's big investment. You know, and it's about train power to train. It's about hydrogen use in trains. So again, another big investment and another project which is worth taking the teeth in. And interestingly enough, also in the world of maritime, and there is a lot of maritime in Scotland, a lot of coast, right, and a lot of islands. Then, if you look at the total supply chain of the maritime sector, that's a lot of opportunities. And you're looking at ammonia, hydrogen, you're looking at methanol, biogas, but carbon capture. So there's a lot of area where in the world, you know, it could be the hydrogen flow, it could be electricity flow, or other energy, and it's the whole supply chain from creating the energy source all the way to using it. And what you do with the exhaust, which we talked about. So you can see here a lot of green boxes, which all are opportunities in that mine plan, opportunities for innovation, and how you tap into it. In the industry, there's two big outcomes looking at is decarbonization and how you do everything you can to decarbonize the industry, the engineering and manufacturing industry, and the technology to get there, and not least carbon capture, utilization and storage. We talked about it, and we talked also about hydrogen and the keen interest, for example, that the food and drink sector has in hydrogen, and the possibility to provide heat. So my understanding is boiler, like industrial boilers based on electricity is not there yet, but hydrogen, we deliver that. So if you look at what are the actions, then the focus is on, you know, carbon capture, utilization, storage, and even carbon capture with bio-based net energy, bio-based carbon capture, and hydrogen. That's the two big sectors that in industry they're looking for. And then the way to get there is innovations and get a deep, what they call a deeper decarbonizations. So how do you innovate, as I said, to get that industry to be net zero? And to do that, you need skills. So again, you can see that there is a green job fund, we've talked about it, but there is also in the industry specifically how you reskill and upskill all the offshore oil and gas and skills that we've got already in Scotland. And those just need to be upskilling or reskilling maybe, but then you don't start from scratch. That's the key thing. But again, they've put themselves a stick if the carrot doesn't work. And that is the ETS and the UK, establishing UK ETS. So that's a cost for a company that is still emits. The more you emit, the more costly it is. And that's what is being argued, the greenwashing is company with deep pocket, just use those to become net zero. And the other one is policy and how they may develop policy that support the outcome they are looking for. So again, you have to look out and be prepared for that. One of the big projects for the industry, the one everybody has probably heard of is Nexus. And that's really focused on carbon capture, that's really focused on hydrogen, and that's really focused on the oil and gas industry. And how can we use all that oil and gas and offshore wind and inshore wind, all that information, all that knowledge, skills, what we've got already in house, how can we leverage that to deliver net zero? And an interesting piece here, as I spoke about it before, the hydrogen coast, which is the east coast of Scotland, then 80% of the industry emissions are within that band, within that hydrogen east coast, if you want. So that's where the interest come from, you know, hydrogen carbon capture. And within Nexus, you've got other opportunities, you know, like Scotland Net Zero Roadmap projects. You know, again, it gives you here an idea about, you know, carbon capture and switching fuel and hydrogen generations and electrification and offshore wind farm. And it's almost technology that gives you opportunity for innovation. It gives you opportunity to tap into, to use your skills, your knowledge on how to get there. And the other thing you can see here is how you've got all those facilities. It could be bioenergy, carbon capture, BECCS, or you could have carbon capture, utilization and storage, we talked about. You've got hydrogen, you've got the whole supply chain there. And it's how can you tap into your skills and knowledge and products to leverage those opportunities that net zero is opening. And that's what the innovation piece of that presentation is about. It's about trying to make you think about, you know, just looking in the box, outside the box, in the corner, under the flap, behind the stickers, everywhere, is that what are the opportunities open? And as part of Nexus, the big one, a big part of Nexus is Acorn. So that's another big project, which now is focused on the carbon capture, which is really what can be done straight away. We're almost ready for that. So it's highly advanced. So what's the takeaway from this piece? Is that, you know, if you think about the defining, so the Scottish Government, as I said, have committed to be net zero by 2045. And then, as mentioned, then to do that and get there, they're using the carrot of investment in the project I've just described, and funding, especially skills funding, which is going to come next. But we need to be aware that if they don't see those outcomes, then they lose the stakes of regulation, legislation, and taxonomy. So that's what we're trying to do here. That's what we're trying to get ready, so it doesn't hurt when it comes along, because it will come along if it doesn't happen. So I've just talked about the skills, what skills, and how do you get those skills in relation to those chapters. So there is a recognition that if you look at the proportion of job needed for reskilling, in the building sector, then 30% of the people are going to need upskilling or reskilling. In the transport sector, you're looking at about 25%, which is a quarter. So 30% is about a third, and a second third, and 25% is a quarter. And a fifth, 20% in the industry. So you can see here from the graph where this is needed, and not surprisingly, there's a lot of reskilling needed in the Aberdeenshire area because of the oil and gas sectors. You've got also in the central belt. But if you look on the left-hand side, then you see that in terms of reskilling, those three sectors, building or constructions and transport and industry, are the main ones, are the one that keeps coming at the top of the need for reskilling. So if you want to scale for net zero in the building sector, it's about hydrogen and the infrastructure that come with it. It's about retrofitting all to make sure no one left is behind. And then what you need there is specialist skills for retrofitting the new technology, the new materials, and surveyors to assess this. Heat pumps is a big one, as well as heat networks. And it's about their installation, it's about their maintenance, it's about their distribution again, it's about heat. And how you deliver heat locally, how do you develop micro generation, thinking about it. And that's what you have in the on-site energy, is how you develop technology to create energy either within the community, which is what we look at with our solar panel, feeding the Wi-Fi on those buildings, but also how you can develop it as heat pumps at a local level, local to the mean household level. So that's in building. In terms of transport, I would strongly recommend that you look at joining the rail cluster builder, which is looking at those skills that are needed for the rail industry for electricity and hydrogen in rail. For the industry, I would strongly recommend that you join the Fortnite offshore cluster, which also is going to be looking at skills and how you can the offshore renewable infrastructure. We would support that, and your floating offshore is a big one at the moment. So those are areas for the skills. And so what sort of skills? If I look at the building sector, then you're going to need skills in legislation, because they're going to change the legislation to make sure that the regulation and legislation to make sure that the buildings are on net zero. You're looking at planning. And in terms of services, we talked about it. Sustainability, renewables, architects and planners are going to be needed. Skills in constructions, contributing new materials, new technology, new equipment. And in terms of building products, then again, it's about the supply chains and materials. And again, it's about understanding how you use them, understanding their efficiency. So that's all the skills you're going to need in terms of the building chapter. If I look at transportation, the key area are passenger transport. And you're looking at rail, and I've mentioned the rail cluster. You're talking about the infrastructure, and I've mentioned Scottish Power, for example, looking at buses. And you're looking at technology, so you're looking at networks here, but also autonomous transport or e-scooter, that sort of thing. And then the other area, you need skills, is freight, logistic industry, and what they are highlighting here. Pardon me. Is safe and efficient driving, Nothing to do with COVID, I promise. So that's how you retrain your employee to be efficient drivers. So that's a freight side. That's what they call self-aid, but also that's where you're looking at in terms of transport, how you try minimize the transportation, but also when you have transportation, how you use more efficient way to more net zero way to do the transportation. As a reminder, that falls within the scope 3 of your net zero ambitions. And then in the automotive industry, there is a big one, the vehicles, and how you're going to build those vehicles, how you're going to maintain those vehicles, how you're going to manage those vehicles, you know, and that goes all the way from, you know, selling them to the roadside assistance. And finally, if you look at industry, the skills are really within Scotland, the oil and gas skills, and how do you reskill, upskill? There's a lot of opportunity for that net zero creates to move away from oil and gas to more renewable, but you need the skills to get there. On the lesser levels, you have the biofuels and the food and drink industry. I've mentioned that, especially the distillery side of things and the spirit side of things. But it's about technology, hydrogen, but we've also talked about it from a food point of view. So if you think about restaurants, if you think about catering, if you think about, you know, how can they use maybe hydrogen rather than using gas? And so that's the sort of area that skills are going to be needed. Now, where do you get those skills? Then there are centers and supports all around Scotland. In here, I've highlighted especially the Construction Scotland Innovation Centre on the West Coast. If you go on the East Coast and you think about digitalization, you've got the Data Lab. If you go further north and you think about sustainable mobility, you've got the Mission Scotland Innovation Park. So what you have and what I'm showing you here is the fact that those skills are available, they exist and they are available. You just need to find the right center that works for your specific ambitions, your specific roadmap, and I come back to that. And how do you get them, how do you fund them? So the other area is obviously academia, and you see F or OSF. And it can be open university, so that's something you do yourself from home, from work. But it could be also universities and colleges like West College Scotland or Strathclyde University, or it could be institutes like NMIS. So there's a lot of choices of where you get them. And also you can look at institutions rather than looking at academia, so more on the social side of things. So you've got, for example, the Mission Innovation Park for transport and mobility, you've got construction industry in CITB, or you've got the digitalization for industry like data skills for work. But the one I highlight usually and I point you towards is that find business support. And the reason for that is you can see when I checked yesterday, there was almost 500 options for support, and almost 100 of them were funding. So not all of them are valid, and not all of them are applicable to whatever you want to look at. But it's a good first place to start. And there is opportunity, there is options, and that includes the skills part, which is the one at the bottom. And as you saw, an example is that Skills for Growth, which is fully funded. You've got the Data Skills Credit Scheme. So if you think about digitalization and IoT and that sort of things, or you've got even an individual training account by Scottish Government Scotland. So there are opportunities for funding the retraining. So there is, to remind you, the employee are keen to gain new skills. And it's a fear of missing out, and in that sense, that the robots are going to take my job. That's a fear people have, and therefore, it's how you where you get those skills and how you fund the skills. That's why it's key here. So another example of funding is you've got West Scottish Commons, which is a college. It's part of the FOSF form. And then you have what I call the individual trainee as much with ideas, but you've also got the all on the job, and that's the modern apprenticeships or adopting apprenticeships. So there are opportunities with colleges to get funding and support and get the skills. So that's quite important. And on the job is a key one with the apprentice, which we would strongly recommend. So what's your takeaway here? Well, your innovation is new price services become the need of new skills. So when you've got, we were talking about innovation in the first part, discover, and define, we talked about the projects in where you can use those innovations and you can leverage the opportunities. In develop, we're looking at getting the skills, and that's key because with new innovation will come need for new skills. In the world of building, you're looking at pumps and heat generation efficiency, which is pump network. In the world of transport, you're looking at the whole supply chain from the sale, the maintenance, the repair, the reuse, and the remanufacturing, that circular economy, and so on. And in terms of industry, you're looking at Industry 4.0, digitalizations. And the key thing here is guidance and support is available. It's available from Scottish Engineering, it's available from Scottish Enterprise, it's available from SDS. So you can get the support, and that's why I encourage you to going back to that program of the one-to-one is we can help, we're here to help. George, don't hesitate to reach out. So that would be the takeaway. And finally, you need a roadmap. So what does that mean, getting a roadmap? So why now? Why? Because it's a compulsory requirement. And what I mean, in terms of procurement policy notice I've got here, which is been updated, and any governmental contract now, they will look at your carbon reduction plan. So it will be a compulsory requirement to have a carbon reduction plan when you are bidding for government contracts or when your customer is bidding for government contract. Because when your customer is, the easiest way for them to get a carbon reduction plan is to come to you and say, what is your carbon reduction plan? So that's the when. And who, the supplier, whoever that is, being you at the time or your customer, if you're subcontracted, and where, that's where you define your organization boundaries. That's where you agree with your customer what your organization boundaries are. An example I've been mentioning is, do you do cradle to gate or do you do cradle to grave? So that's a sort of conversation you need to have with your customer. And how, so they've defined clearly in that notice that they are using a carbon reduction plan on the greenhouse gas protocol. So that's what they're going to use to develop that need. So that's why, another why you need to do it now is because you've got e-source, the energy saving opportunity schemes I mentioned about the stick of reporting. And that's what this is about. This is about reporting your energy usage and your energy savings. And I've put the key question here. So if you are in a UK establishment, yes, it will apply to you. And if you are not an undertaking, but you employ either 250 people or have a turnover of 44 million, then you need to do it. One of the way out is if you are ISO 50001, then you don't need to do it. So you've got a new deadline for the next round, which is, I believe, round three. But here you can see that it may not concern you today, but you can see a reporting is coming online. So with the previous slide, you saw how, I would say, slide We sort of have the need to apply, the need for a policy, the need for a model map or a carbon reduction plan. If you're looking at getting into government contracts, either directly or indirectly, and here you can see how it's about reporting. So that's a winner. So where you've got choices and how you measure it. So you've got the greenhouse gas protocol, which is always used, which is how it all started. And you can see how it relates to what we talked about in previous webinars, which is smart, which is specific. It's specific, it's measurable, it's achievable, realistic, and time-bound. Time-bound is a key one. And what you have here is various sections of the greenhouse gas protocol. I look at when you see corporate, think organization rather than just corporation. And then you the project, so that's where you develop a specific project, and then you've got scope three, and then you've got looking at the life cycle. So you've got the four sections for the greenhouse gas protocol. So the advantage of it at global is used by a range of organizations. The next one will be the ISO 14060 series, and in there you've got 64 part 1, 2, and 3. And those are again same concept. It's about greenhouse gas reduction, same organization, so or same framework. So you've got organization level, which is part one, project level, which is part two, and then the verification validation, which is part three. And when you marry the three of them, then that's how you get your greenhouse gas statement. So again, the advantage of that is recognized, it's international, it's ISO, but it's not used by the British government. The British government decided to go for the protocol. So that's where you go to the idea about your roadmap and idea about what you use is how you minimize the education of your customers. So whatever is used in your industry is what you want to use. Whatever they understand is what you want to use. Why a standard? Well, the advantage of using a standard is then it's auditable, and you move away from the accusation of you set up something, a way of measuring things that should you run being accurate. So that's the concept behind it. And the last one, which is national, is a PES series, so they go 2015, 2060. And again, you can see here how it's strongly stamped or influenced by the ISO standard, because you recognize those ISO standards as presuming to meet those principles. So that's what we're showing you here. But that's national. So it doesn't have the international recognition that the other one do. But again, that's maybe something your customer is more familiar with. So that's what you want to think about. So how do you go about it? And that's something I shared in the previous webinars. And really what you want to do is focus on pillar 1 and 2, which is about reducing your emission and having a look at reducing your value chain emission. 3 and 4 can come at a later date. That would be all recommendations. It's not simple. So if I look at 1, it's about reducing your own emissions. So what you're looking at is you're looking at the use of renewable energy. You're looking at your building, its heating, its ventilations, and you're looking at commuting. So what people may be working from home or hybrid working or minimizing commuting or public transport or active travel. And then you're looking at transportation of goods, which is your vehicle fleets, or you're looking at transportation of people, which is business travel. Do you need to do all that business travel? When you do business travel, can you do it by train or doing it by plane or by car? So that the public transport, basically, and minimize the waste. And that's something that every organization is aware of, is how do you minimize waste and fall more under, I would say, the lean view of it. And in pillar 2, what you're looking at is minimize your scope 3. So you start to think about scope 3. So you, pillar 1, you think about scope 1 and 2. And that's the one you control the most because they are within your boundaries. And then scope 3, it can be difficult, a bit more challenging. But what you're looking at here is when you design or make a product or a service, then what emission does that generate? So you're looking at the design piece, performance, etc. And then the other bits you start looking at here is, as I say, is your commuting and then your investment. Where do you put your investment? You know, and the suggestion here is pension funds, and more pension funds are looking at net zero pension funds. You know, is that the sort of thing where you want to put your money as a business? And then you look at your suppliers. So do you prioritize suppliers that have a plan, that have a vision, that have a roadmap? You know, how can you do that? Is it affordable? So that is sort of thing you need to look at, which has an impact on your supply chain. And the same thing, supplier of services, so the people that do the delivery on your behalf or transportation. So that would be the two key areas. In terms of funding, then again, there is a lot of opportunity. So examples would be, you know, so I mentioned fine business support before, but what we look at is a lot of carbon innovation, for example, or interface, which is looking at vouchers and connecting you with academia. You've got net zero scoring, which is a big thing on EPOM, but it's about circularity. And you could have some interesting funding if you are prepared to let some of your equity go for 100% of your funding. And that's an interesting one from KTN, which I'm writing here. So funding is available. So what's the takeaway from this? So why now? Because it's happening. You've seen it through the procurement policy. You've seen it through reporting. So it's happening. It's coming. And the stick as well as the carrots are coming. And then you need to identify the standards that your customers and your industry is familiar with in order to minimize the educations. And the strong recommendation, make it smart. Start with scope 1 and 2. Keep it simple. Don't overdo it, but be ready. It's coming. There's going to be no way to avoid it. It's coming, and the radio you are, the safer you're going to be. So if I summarize the webinar today, we looked at innovation and creating a vision, innovation in Scotland, in the UK, and further afield. And we looked at the opportunities that innovation can tap into, and we narrowed it down to really the outcomes that the Scottish Government is looking at, and therefore their actions to deliver these outcomes, and projects are already ongoing, you can get your teeth in, the skills and the wide range of skills you're going to need, and how you can access and fund them, and where you can get them to deliver that capability to play. So you've got a vision, you've got motivation, you've got the capability to deliver that vision and answer that motivations. And then the last one needed is a roadmap. And as we talked about tools, we talked about standards, tools being the standards or the GNU-GAD protocols or the PA series, and where you can get funding. And all that outcome of that, I think those three chapters would be innovations. So that's the summary of what we looked at today. So I would like to take that opportunity to thank you all for attending the meeting. And I will answer any question you may have.
Well, unfortunately, I think it's been a lot today, so we're out of time. We have a few folks that have said thanks, but they have to drop off. They'll look for the slides and for the recording later on. We're just a little bit over 3 minutes past 10. So I think I want to wrap it up there. What I'd like to say is any questions, comments, and Eric's offer to pick up with companies on a one-to-one basis remains. We're the easiest bunch in the world to get a hold of, I hope. All the details are on the net zero page, it's on our website. Phone up. We like old-fashioned phone calls, and we'll connect and we'll sort out some time to come and talk to you. And I think at that, we'll let you get on with your day. Thanks for your patience and holding on. I hope we have a good rest of the day, and we'll see you again very soon. Okay.
Okay.
Thanks all.
Thank you.